seminar that Please Turn Your Phones Off forms part of the NRF SARChI Gen Political Theory Seminar Series. This afternoon, we're very grateful to have Professor Sabelo Ndlovu-Gatsheni giving the seminar. He just flew in from Rwanda and Kenya straight from the airport, so please bear that in mind when you ask your questions. Prof is Executive Director in the Department for Transformation and Leadership at UNISA, as well as a full professor in Development Studies, but more importantly, and relevant to today's seminar, someone who's been thinking about epistemic injustice for a long time, even before the 2015-2016 student movements recenter the question. Someone who's worked with institutes on the continent like Kodestria, who've been instrumental in the type of epistemological reimagining that students are now looking for. So someone who has a long history in working in these issues and who we're very excited to have with us this afternoon. He's going to speak for about 45 minutes on the idea of decolonizing the university and epistemic freedom, and then we'll have questions.
Thank you so much for the introduction. I hope I will sustain 45 minutes. Maybe some few. I try to give a preface. When Professor Lawrence Hamilton invited me here, it was on the basis of a book which I just published, the one entitled "Epistemic Freedom in Africa: Deprovincialization and the Decolonization." So I asked him, what exactly do you want me to talk about? He said, talk about your book. The second preface which I want to put forward, I see this is a chair in political theory. Despite the fact that my professorship is in development studies, but fundamentally I'm a historian. Because of that, sometimes I'm intimidated by issues of theory, particularly political theory. But I will try to speak about some of the theoretical issues which I think I've pondered. And I think to start off, I think we must think about three related concepts. One is academic freedom. The second one is epistemic freedom. And the third one is academic democracy. And this lecture, I think, circulates around those three concepts. And what actually hangs them together is the tropical issue of decolonization, particularly decolonization of knowledge. That's what actually hangs whatever I'm going to say today. And there are a few issues which we need to bear in mind before I move to the core of the lecture. The first one are the questions around the current question of decolonization. The first issue which I think we need to think about is that ever since we began to talk about decolonization, particularly from Africa and from the global south, there are some scholars in other parts of the world who have actually tried to then respond by re-articulating the empire and arguing that the empire was not dangerous, it was also beneficial to those who were colonized. And they tried to draw a balance sheet of the empire. Even here, you know about the sentiments of Helen Zille, that colonialism was beneficial. So that's one thing which makes us to speak about the issues of decolonization and the empire today. The second one, there is also a number of people who believe that decolonization was a 20th century phenomenon. And those who argue that way, they think that when we're talking about decolonization, we're talking about something which belongs to the past. And they go further to argue that those who are constantly talking about decolonization, particularly in Africa, are actually engaged in compensatory behavior, whereby the failure of the regimes, the failure of economic development, and everything, we blame colonization. So there's that other argument. Then there is a third one, which comes from those who are actually beneficiaries of colonialism. And the beneficiaries of colonialism always argue that whenever you speak about decolonization, they then caricature that, and they always want to distort what you are saying. So I want us to listen carefully to what I'm saying. I've spoken many times about this topic, and the people ask the same questions. Some of the questions which we have answered already, they repeat them. They can't move beyond asking similar questions. They listen to themselves, not to what I'm saying. The fourth issue, which I think makes it very pertinent for us to talk about decolonization today, is that throughout the world, not only in South Africa, not only on the continent, but at a planetary level, there is resurgence and insurgence of decolonization in various forms. And the other factor which is important, particularly because we're meeting within a university, is that these struggles, unlike those of the 19th century, they are actually playing themselves within institutions of higher education. And it is important for us to then explain what are the implications for a transformation, decolonization, and Africanization within the universities. But there is also a fundamental question which we need to deal with when we speak about decolonization and epistemic freedom. And this is the question: are we sure that the decolonization which we are talking about is the right vehicle to take us beyond the crisis which we are facing? Those are important questions which we need. Are we sure that if we deploy decolonization, or we call it decoloniality properly, we will then resolve issues of racism, issues of patriarchy, issues of sexism, issues of domination, issues of inequality? That's a fundamental question which we need to deal with. But coming to the concepts, I think the most popular concept is that of academic freedom. And I think that one everyone knows. And when I'm talking about epistemic freedom, I'm not substituting academic freedom for epistemic freedom. I'm thinking, the way I think is that there is need for us to put content to academic freedom. And when you speak about epistemic freedom, you're actually putting content to academic freedom beyond being just speech rights. And one of the issues is that when you speak about academic freedom, you're speaking about something related to epistemic freedom, but which is different. And the differences, I will try to then speak about them. The academic freedom speaks about rights, as I said, and it is not a small part of debates in Africa. As you would all remember, the Kampala Declaration on Intellectual Freedom and Social Responsibility of 1990, where the African scholars met and they affirmed the rights of intellectuals and academics to pursue knowledge and disseminate it. They also affirmed the social responsibility of intellectuals and academics to society. They also affirmed the autonomy of higher institutions of higher education. They also highlighted the responsibility of the state to the institutions of higher education, and they underscored the fact that education is a human right. So you see the linkages between the fees must fall and that event which took place in 1990. But when we speak about academic freedom without speaking about epistemic freedom, we then remain in a very problematic space where some people are using academic freedom to protect and to continue some of the practices which are not actually emancipatory and liberatory. And the academic freedom on its own can actually lead to what we call maintenance of knowledges of equilibrium, the knowledges of status quo. And when we then move to epistemic freedom, it's not something which you just wake up in the morning and say, now, let me try to be different and not talk about academic freedom, let me talk about epistemic freedom. We're actually thinking about epistemic freedom at a particular moment in global history where there is a double crisis. And that double crisis, for lack of better terms, I will explain them in terms of systemic crisis and the epistemic crisis. And I will try to elaborate what we mean by that. At a systemic level, the issue is that we are facing a world whereby everyone agrees that capitalism as a world system generates poverty, inequality, and other problems. But the same people who identify capitalism as a problem, when you ask them about the solution and the way forward, they then prescribe more capitalism. You say in South Africa, it is the most unequal society in the world. But what is the solution? More capitalism. We need to open for business. We need to liberalize. And my argument is that that's decadence. That's the end of thinking when you see people doing that. They blame the same thing, but they say the same thing is the solution. And the second part of understanding the epistemic crisis, I'm not sure whether it's me alone who sees these problems. The problem of the exhaustion of the knowledge which carried us for the past 500 years. The exhaustion of the knowledge which carried us for the past 500 years. And that exhaustion of knowledge, the Portuguese sociologist Bonaventura de Sousa Santos said it manifests itself in a lack of new nouns. He said, during this time when it was very vibrant, new nouns were being produced constantly. Nouns like democracy, development, but nowadays we are only adding adjectives to existing nouns. In other words, when you say democracy, you just add popular. When you now talk about development, you just add another adjective again, local development. You can no longer generate new nouns. So that takes us to say, if we agree that there is a systemic crisis and also there is an epistemic crisis, the argument which then arises, should we continue with the knowledges which plunged us into the present crisis? Or should we think about other knowledges? That's not a very profound argument. The scientist Einstein said it long ago, that the knowledges which took you to a crisis cannot be the same knowledges which take you out of the crisis. So that's why we need to think then about the issues of epistemic freedom. If you read the work of the Pan-Africanist Kwesi Pram, he actually prefers to use the word intellectual sovereignty in production and the reproduction of knowledge. And we want to try and elaborate the whole issue of epistemic freedom in terms of right to think, to write, to theorize, to communicate, to interpret the world as yourself and from where you are. And that question was not going to arise if it was not for colonization and the coloniality of knowledge, which actually makes people who are seated here with us today, physically here, but epistemologically somewhere else. From preschool, secondary school, up to university, the Western, and I want to put that in quotation marks, Western knowledge is always taking you away and away from your culture, from your history, from your communities, to the extent that you become external to your reality. So that's one argument which we try. And the second aspect is a very easier one. We speak about epistemic freedom only because we want to achieve relevance. We want to achieve to be relevant. Mahmoud Mamdani once wrote that the problem with African thought about African problems is that every time we diagnose the problems internally, but whenever we're looking for solutions, we then go outside. And those solutions generally tend not to work. But there is already a strong counter-argument to what I said. And that strong counter-argument comes from people whom I will, for lack of a better term, I will call globalists. The globalists, they argue that it doesn't make sense to talk about African knowledge, Caribbean knowledge, Asian knowledge, European knowledge. They think that the best term for our period is global economy of knowledge. And what I'm going to offer is a rebuttal of that argument. Of course, globalization has linked us across the world, but there are still problems in terms of the knowledge, the valid knowledge is still coming from a well-known center, and that center being North America and Europe. So that's one issue which we need maybe to think about. But even when we're speaking about global economy of knowledge, it still cascades from a single center, which is Europe and North America. And the second argument which we need to raise in relation to the issue of global economy of knowledge is that of uneven division of labor within that global economy of knowledge. And that uneven division of labor manifests itself very clearly for those who are doing research in the global south, in Africa, in many parts of this part of the world. Academics reduced to hunting and gathering of raw data. Academics being reduced to native informants. And once we have gathered the raw data, it is then processed somewhere. And it is always processed in North America and in Europe. And what we then do, this part of the world, we then consume the theories developed somewhere. And this explains why you will find among us here so many people who are calling themselves Marxists, Foucauldian, Derridian. They have all these surnames. And these surnames actually reflect another problem in the so-called global economy of knowledge. And that is the problem of intellectual dependence. Intellectual dependence, where you depend on the theories from somewhere. And even when we do training for doctoral and masters, we push our students and ask them, what theory are you going to use? And the assumption creates this impression that theories are in a tin somewhere at a corner, and you need just to choose one. We don't go deeper and say, we want to train you to formulate a theory. We want to train you to use existing theories. And you use them historically, you use them trans-historically. And on a practical basis, for all who are academics like me, we all know that in order have stature within the modern the global economy of knowledge, you must know where to publish your work. And that still reflects the dependency. You need to publish, if they are saying international, they don't mean Nigeria, they don't mean Rwanda, where I was. They actually mean North America and Europe. When you want to get an A rating from NRIF, you must know that you must have what is called international recognition. And that international recognition comes in terms of being recognized in Europe, North America. If you are recognized locally here, obviously you are going to get a C, if not worse. But for us to appreciate what I've said, it's important for also to do what we call a grass cutting, whereby we